Thank you. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me. I'm sure it must have been a splendid workshop. Unfortunately, I missed most of it for personal reasons. Okay, so let's go ahead. So this is joint work with Jaikumar, Radhakrishnan, and Atri, Rudra. So I don't think too many speakers, or for that matter, any speaker has formally talked about communication complexity. So I just thought that I would start with the basic model of communication complexity, which is two-party communication. The topic of my talk is a certain generalization of this, which I will come to later. So here's two-party communication complexity, which was introduced in 1979 and now is an extremely flourishing and active field of research within computational complexity. And not only has it affected communication computational complexity, but it has also been of has all sorts of connections with almost every field of theoretical computer science and perhaps computer science in general. So let's I will try to breeze through it. Many of you might already be familiar with it. So here's the model. So there are two players, Alice and Bob, who have unbounded computational power, right? So the amount of computation they can do is not restricted at all. They can solve undecidable problems and whatnot. So they want to jointly compute a function. The problem is, you know, one of the input to that function has been divided between the two players. Alice gets part of the input, and the remaining part of the input is headed to Bob. So the only bottleneck in computing is information, because neither does Alice have the entire input, nor does Bob. Okay, and what they want to do is to mutually agree upon communication protocol such that they communicate as little as possible and yet solve the problem, evaluate the function that they jointly want to evaluate on the given input. Okay? So this function I will denote as depending on x and y, where x is Alice's part of the input and y is Bob's part of the input. And the communication protocol goes as follows. So you know, think of it as a protocol tree, which determines who's to speak at what at a given juncture. And so let's say Alice starts the protocol, so she, doing her input, is free to compute any function of her input as a bit. So she computes a function, let's call it A1, which is an arbitrary function of her input. Of course, the function that she computes on her input, that function is known to Bob as well, because that's part of the specification of the protocol. And then you know, Bob sends back some information, computing again an arbitrary function. And now this function depends on the input that Bob has and whatever Alice sent her in the previous round. So they take rounds, and this goes on. And at each point, the what is communicated by a particular player depends only on the input of that player and what has been communicated until then. Okay, and then let's say Bob at the final round, the RF round, gives the answer to Alice, and you know, at this point, both Alice and Bob agree that the bit BR is the value of the Boolean function f on x and y. And a protocol is correct if it always gives the right answer. Okay? That's the basic deterministic model of communication. Yeah, it's a Boolean function, for simplicity. In general, it could be other things, but in this talk, we will confine ourselves to Boolean functions. So aim for Alice and Bob is to minimize the communication cost. And the communication cost of a protocol is going to be the worst case cost. So, you know, adversarially, given a protocol, somebody chooses X, the adversary chooses X and Y, such that it maximizes the cost of the protocol, and that would be the cost. And in communication complexity, you know, the cost can at most be n plus 1, right? Because, okay, so I forgot to say that x and y are both worth n bits. So they are n bit strings. So always in, for computing any function f, Alice can always send her entire input to Bob, who then computes the answer and gives back the answer, right? So complexity of any function is at most n plus 1. What we are interested is in, you know, what kind of structure, combinatorial structure of f allows Alice and Bob to minimize, to communicate much less than n plus 1. And just as in computational complexity, polynomial cost is considered to be efficient, here log of n typically would be considered an efficient protocol, or for that matter, any polylogarithmic cost would be considered efficient. Okay. So this quickly run through some easy examples. So if Alice and Bob want to compute the parity function on n bits, Alice has n bits, Bob has n bits. Of course, now you can do much less than sending n plus 1 bits, because Alice can just send the parity of the bits that she sees, and then Bob, knowing that, can send back the answer. So you know, this cost is just 2, right? So this is a much cheaper way of computing parity than the naive way of sending n plus 1. And there is another example of function like the majority function, which can be computed in logarithmic cost. It's an easy exercise. So there are functions like parity, majority, or for that matter, any symmetric function, which depends only on the number of ones, can be computed very efficiently in log of n cost. So what's a hard function? The thrust of this talk is going to be on hard functions. So if you look at deterministic protocols, how about equality? This is a function that is used most of the time in practice, because if Alice holds a file and Bob holds a file, they want to be sure if the two files are the same, whether they've been corrupted or not. Right? If you make two copies of the same file, you want to be sure whether the two copies are identical to each other. Okay, so this is actually a very widely used function. So equality, meaning whether x as an n-bit string is the same as y. And intuitively, this should require n bits of communication, because you know, unless, deterministically, unless you have, Bob knows all the n bits of Alice, how can he be sure whether they've got the same string? But this needs an argument, and I'll run through this argument because it will be useful at some point in my talk. So how do we formally say that this requires n bits? And here's the key observation, a very simple but very powerful observation about two-party communication, which shows their weakness, which gets used very effectively for proving local bounds, which is the rectangularity of protocols, right? Which is the following. So imagine the following thing. Alice has got some input x, and we look at pairs of inputs, so x, y, and x prime, y prime. So in the first pair of inputs, Alice has got x, Bob has got y. In the second pair, Alice has got x prime, Bob has got y prime. Now, if it so happens that the communication transcript of these two protocols, the transcript is the entire message history, if this happens to be the same for these pairs of input, right, then it's simple but very useful to observe that the history would be the same even if I swap on Bob's side y from y to y prime and keep Alice's part the same. So if the pair x y prime, the protocol is doomed to sort of play the same history, just because you can fool Alice and Bob. As I said in the model, if you think about it, what Alice communicates only depends on her input and the communication history thus far, right? So the transcript would remain exactly the same, and also symmetrically, if you swap on Alice's side, keeping Bob the same, the transcript would not change. Okay, so this can be summarized in a nice way, which says that every transcript corresponds to some rectangle, combinatorial rectangle, which is a product of two sets. One is a subset on Alice's side, and the other is a subset on Bob's side. Okay. And now let's get back to equality. Armed with this observation, what do we see? So let's look at this sort of communication matrix, which has the set of rows as the possible inputs of Alice, and the set of columns as the possible inputs of Bob. And if you look at the equality function, it's a very sparse matrix. It's exactly the identity matrix, right? Because on the diagonals are the place where Alice and Bob are the same, and that you have only one there. And from what I just said before, the fact, an easy fact follows, which is that no two diagonal entries can share, for a correct protocol,
can share the same transfer.
Because if they did, then, for example, let's say, you know, these, this particular entry and this entry, both on the diagonal, share the same transcript, then the rectangularity of protocols would say the same transcript would be generated for this pair as well as for this pair, and that cannot be the case, right? Because these pairs have a different answer. Okay? And if you look at an, if you look at the number of this particular matrix is 2 to the n by 2 to the n. For all these ones on the diagonal, you need to have a different transcript, and which just says that you will require at least n bits of string to be sent just to answer things on the diagonal correctly, plus one, because you know you need to have a different transcript for answering when things are not. Okay? So this is one case where we can get exactly the right answer, showing that n plus 1 is the best that you can do. Okay, so it's a very simple argument, but a very useful one. So let me show you another example of the other function that will come again in my talk, which is called the set-disjointness function. This is a function which is sort of very useful and very important in communication complexity, especially in applying communication complexity to other areas of computer science. This is a function that always shows up. And what is this function? So this is a function where, again, Alice and Bob have two strings, each 10 bit long. But now I want to sort of view, the name set disjointness comes from the fact that I want to view these strings as subsets. So imagine you have a universe of elements of from 1 to n, and Alice and Bob have got a characteristic vector. Each one has got a characteristic vector of the subset. Okay? And you want to ensure that the two sets do not intersect. They do not have any element in common.
So
in this particular case, of course, they do have an element in common, because you know the column corresponding the element corresponding to this column is shared by Alice and Bob, so of course this one is 0, right? And here's a simple, for fun, I just wanted to say, one can show that the communication complexity, deterministic communication complexity of this particular function is again n plus 1, because if you consider these sets, the pairs of input where Alice has got a particular set and Bob has exactly its complement, okay, then you can show that these pairs, again there are 2 to the n such pairs, these pairs have to generate a different transcript, because if they generated the same if any two pairs generated the same transcript, you will have a problem, because for either you will generate the same transcript for A, B complement, or B, A complement, and one of these have to intersect. This is the effect. So again, this shows that all 2 to the n inputs form a set and its complement, they should generate distinct transcripts. And again, this can be used to show that the communication complexity is n plus 1. Yes. Now I come to because we will deal with random protocols, can randomization help? Right? So here's a simple example to show you that randomness does help here in communication complexity. Let's go back to the same function equality that I just talked about. So now, we saw that equality required n plus 1 bits of communication deterministically. However, with randomness, we can get away by a much cheaper protocol. Why? Because, and by randomness, the particular model, so I'm not formally defining this model, but you have, you can interrupt and ask me if you don't understand anything. So here I will deal with what is called the public coin model, where Alice and Bob share random bits, okay? And they can flip coins together. Things are perfectly random, and they are not charged for doing that. Okay, so they have infinite source of randomness. So in this, here's a way of using that to solve equality very easily. Alice and Bob, you know, take toss n bits of coins at random, and then Alice does the inner product of x, the string x, with the random bits that they jointly tossed, and just sends one bit inner product xr modulo 2, which is a one bit information that, that she sends to Bob. And Bob, in this particular case, is one. Bob just, you know, checks, does the same, does the inner product of y with the same random string r, and checks if these two inner products match. Of course, if x is equal to y, they will match. Right? So when x is equal to y, we always get the same answer. And the key observation is when x is different from y, with exactly probably half, they will not match. And so they will be able to detect it. Okay? And you can repeat this protocol a few times to improve the probability of success. So this shows that randomized protocols can be much more powerful, right? So equality, which was a very hard function, suddenly becomes actually a very easy function if you allow randomness. Okay? And here's my last slide on two-party protocols, or the penultimate slide, sorry. So limits of random protocols. So what is a function which is even hard for random protocols, right? Not suddenly equality. Well, it turns out that set-disjointness still is a very hard function, even for random protocols. Okay? And this is actually a celebrated result, first shown by Kalyanasundaram and Schnitzer in 87, then simplified by Rasborov. And Rasborov's proof of this has been extremely influential in communication complexity and also outside of communication complexity, like in the proof of the parallel repetition theorem, and in many other ways. So this is a very important result of in classical two-party communication complexity. That the set disjointness is a robustly hard function in the sense that even random protocols need omega n bits to be communicated. Now, I just want to emphasize one thing. In normal communication complexity, so when we talk about this randomized protocol and its complexity, again, it's a worst case complexity, right? So random protocols have to give the right answer for every input with a certain probability. And when you say that omega n bits needs to be communicated, what you mean is that if you take any randomized protocol which solves a disjointness, there is going to be a pair of input on which it will be forced to communicate omega n bits on some public coin toss. Okay? That's what is meant by this statement. So, as I said, there are many applications. I don't need to motivate this crowd for that, so let me just skip that. Okay? Now, here's the model that I'm interested in this talk, which is a model of multi-party communication. Now, there have been many, or at least two, important models of multi-party communication that have been introduced. One is called the number of 4N, which interestingly was the first multi-party communication model introduced. But I will not talk about that. I will talk about the other model, which is a variant of the other model, which is called the number in hand model. So, which is actually can be motivated by what happens in practice. If you have a computer network, this is the model that comes into play, where every computer has got some input and they want to jointly compute some or perform some task, right? Also, now what becomes important is what kind of communication is allowed, right? So there are two possibilities here. One is what is called the broadcast model, and the other is this point-to-point message passing model. And what I will be talking about is the second one, which is the point-to-point model. So it's not broadcast. So you have a network, communication network, which is some graph, and I'll assume each link is undirected, meaning you can communicate in either direction. Okay, so it will be some undirected graph, and every node can only communicate to its neighbors in the graph. And just to keep things simple, we will assume there's this, everybody is synchronized. There's a global clock that is ticking, okay? And at the tick of each clock, the internal state of the protocol will clearly specify who's to communicate to whom, okay? And if the tick of the clock says, I want to communicate to you, you also know at that point that you're expecting something from me. You cannot remain silent. So there are, in general, there will be k nodes in the graph. There is some graph g, and I want to compute some function f, x1 through xk, just as before. So what we have seen so far is a very special case. Two-party communication is a very special case of that, where the graph is just an edge. Okay? And as before, we will consider the randomized model with public random. And the parameter that we'll be interested in for this talk is total communication. And the interesting thing is now that this intuitively, and I'll try to convince you of that, should depend not just on the function as before, because their graph was fixed, just an edge, but also on the structure of the graph. Right? The same function might require less communication to solve on certain graphs than on some other graphs.
So the number in the pool doesn't become a special case of this, for example.
It may, depending on how you apportion the inputs. Right now, what I've said is that x1 through xk are any set of inputs, but if you sort of say that xi and xj overlap, right, then I can do that as well. But usually the number on the forehead is the broadcast model, and I'm not talking about the point-to-point model.
So if there is a machine that wants to sort of send a message to many things, you're going to add up the communication.
Oh yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. So I should say, yeah. So the total, by total communication, what I mean is the sum of bits that have been communicated on all edges. But in certain graphs, you may not be allowed to send to everybody at one clock thing, right? Because who you can talk to is specified by the underlying graph. So there's also this model, we started looking at this as sort of an intellectual curiosity, but it was also sort of motivated by distributed computing. But it's a little different here, in the sense that in distributed computing, typically, the graph is something which is part of the input, it's not known. You sort of discover the graph along the way. Okay, you want to typically compute various graph parameters as part of your computation. Here, the protocol is decided knowing the graph beforehand. Okay? So that's an important difference between what is the typical model in distributed computing and what we are considering here. Okay, this is, I think, very little explored. It is more explored than what we had thought. In the sense that somebody looked at it way back in 1985, which I will refer to, but I think it's largely unexplored, and it is what I would like my message would be to say that we should all look into this, because there's a nice interplay of graph theory and information theory that can be made to bear this. Okay, and so yes, so how much time? Half an hour. So what? Why care about this? Well, as I said, I mean, honestly, it started as an intellectual curiosity, but it looks like very natural, okay, in many parts in distributed computing, of course, with a little difference, as I just said, but if you sort of broadly construe distributed computing, this is something that seems to be a very natural model. Of late, there has been things like distributed functional monitoring. So here I'm just throwing some keywords. I don't want to go into this because I want to get into the meat of the matter. So here's the simplified brain network. So perhaps it has got some bearing on biology as well. Maybe the brain is trying to minimize communication between its various parts, and it wants to design the topology of the network based on that. Who knows? Let me come back to this thing. So here is the Faulkner model again. I'm looking at this multi-party problem where there's a connected graph G. So the graph is of course connected, otherwise it doesn't make sense, right? And more generally, the graph will have more than k nodes, right? K is that number which sort of there are k. So there are the whole input to the function has been divided among k pairs, that's k. But the graph may have certain other nodes as well. Okay. So I think this is the color code. So the red ones, the red nodes here are the nodes. They are coterminals who have input. And the blue nodes are nodes which do not have input to begin with, but they participate in the computation in some way. Right? They may just be routing, but they may be doing other interesting stuff. Okay, so they are computing agents, but they do not have inputs at the beginning. Okay? And each of these k players have a private admit string. They want to compute this function, and which depends on k inputs. And you want to minimize the total number of bits communicated, just as in two-party communication in the worst case. And we can talk about, and I will talk about, again, the deterministic. I mean, we want to understand the randomized model, but it's, of course, it's a good start. It's a good point to start with deterministic communication. Okay?
There could also be a model where you care about bottlenecks in communication. Not just the total number of communication. Two parties are doing something in parallel, then that's probably not as expensive as two people sending it to the same party. Just saying. There could be other models of network condition.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. There are. So, we can talk about that later. So, this right now I'm only interested in total communication, total amount of communication. For example, in two-party, we talk about rounds of communication. How much round? That is something we've looked at recently, but I couldn't get the time to talk about it. You can talk about the rounds of communication in this model as well. Right, and there. Things like congestion show up. Okay.
That's
right. So the communication has at least the number of edges. Yes. Something like that. Yeah. So again, communicate only over edges. Non-player nodes also participate. And to keep matters simple, I'm assuming a synchronous model of communication, meaning there's a global clock. Because in distributed computing, you also have other models where the clock, there's no global clock. Right? So here we are assuming there's a global clock. Okay? And here's the two functions that I want to focus on in the first part of the talk. One is called, it's actually a very natural function, has been used in many other parts of complexity. Which I call the element distinctness function. Okay, so you have k input k strings, and you want to be sure if each pair of the string is if each of the strings is distinct. Is there any pair which is the same? Right. If they are not, you output one. Otherwise, you output zero. So this is called the element distinctness function. And very related is the equality function, which is the case where you want to be sure that all the k strings are equal. Okay? In the k equals 2 case, these are exactly the same function. right? But on a general graph, they have very different topological behavior. Okay? So as I said, for k equals 2, this is a slide that I can quickly skip over. You know, they both become the equality function, and so they are very easy, and they have the same complexity. Okay? They are hard for two players deterministically. Both of them, I mean, their complexity are exactly the same. So they, it's the same function. Okay, but let's now look at a particular graph. Okay, which is like a line or a path. And I want to show you that this, actually just a moment's thought will make it clear to you that on this, on such a graph, these two functions intuitively behave very different. Okay? So let's look at equality. In equality, if you are doing a deterministic protocol, what can you do? Well, I mean, you know, just by the intuition that you have about k equals 2, the best thing possibly seems to be the fact that the protocol where, you know, you start from an end and x1 sends the player sitting at node 1 sends all its end bits to player 2. Then player 2 checks whether these two things are the same, if his input is the same as player 1's. If not, the protocol essentially stops just propagating the answer to the rest of the players, saying, well, I detected already a difference. If he is the same, you know, it continues. Now sends only, of course, n bits, right? Because x1 is equal to x. Okay. So, you know, and this continues, and maybe at some point player I notices a difference and then he just propagates the answer. Okay? And the output is 0. Now, this protocol, of course, has cost about, I'm just ignoring the plus k thing in that. So, you know, the cost of this protocol is about k minus 1 times n, right? Now, so this is for the equality function. Now, let's look at the element distinctness function. In the case of element distinctness, well, things begin the same way. Player 1 sends n bits to player 2. Now player 2, if the two strings are different, cannot afford now to send n bits. It needs to send both x1 and x2 downstream to player 3, right? So now you send 2 n bits, and you continue in this way. Each time you sort of, you can't merge things. If you are in a streaming model, you sort of merge things. Here you're not merging, right? These things cannot be, they don't seem to be merged. And you have to sort of keep the entire information propagating downstream, right? So, if you think about it, so, and maybe from the other end things can start simultaneously, right? Whatever you do, since you sort of keep adding these things, your communication cost seems to be order k squared rather than even, right? So you already notice on this particular graph, which is just a path, the naive way of doing things seems to suggest that the complexities should be different. And again, the graph must be important, right? Because on an edge, they are the same. Okay? On a star, if you think about it, they are again the same. So it's important if there is a difference, it's because the graph should play a role. And that's what I mean by the fact that there's a topological difference between topologically these two functions are different. So, what happens for a randomized protocol? But just taking the cue from the k equals 2 case, now, you know, players send just hashes of the strings, right? For equality, you can just show that you can send these hashes, each hash will be worth order 1 bits. And you just propagate this order 1 bits downstream, so the total cost will be about k. Whereas if you look at element distinctness, it seems that everybody now needs to send about order log k bits of hash. Okay?
K is much larger in our protocol. In the randomized protocol, it will be more than
n. Sorry?
So if k is much larger,
then
the error probability will add up, right?
So that's why I just said order log k bits of hash. just to keep it down.
So, trying to get only a constant error.
Yes. We're only looking at bounded error.
Constant.
Yeah. Bounded away from that. Yeah. So that's why I have that log k factor sneaking in. So, well, this seems to be the thing, right? I mean, it is not, even on this simple graph, on the like the path, you have, I mean, what's the argument to show that this is essentially the best that you can do, right? Now, this becomes a bit more subtle than k equals 2 k's, right? So here's a warm-up example, okay? So it will highlight one aspect that I want to show you, which shows, in some sense, proving lower bounds for randomized protocols strangely could be easier than proving lower bounds for deterministic protocols.
Because?
Of course, because in deterministic protocols, you want to prove stronger bounds, okay? And here's an example of a star. So notice that in the star, as I said, equality and element distinctness, they sort of behave the same way, okay? So one approach that you could think of, so there is identity-bit protocol, as I said before, where you know all the players send to the central guy, the coordinator, and the coordinator gives out the answer, right? So here's a possible argument, right? What you want to do is you want to look at the length of this transcript pi. Pi is the total protocol. And here, pi I is the transcript that is exchanged on this particular edge. Okay? And the cost of pi is just the sum of pi i's, the length of pi i's. Now, one might be tempted to think that if I look at this cut, okay, and I look at all of these things as if they have been given to one player, and player two being another player, then I can induce a two-party game between Alice and Bob, and it seems now that they have to solve two-party equality. And we know that we just saw in the deterministic case that two-party equality requires n bits of communication, right? Okay, and so pi 2, the length of pi 2 in the world, I mean, has to be omega n, right? That is, that's clear. And so the length of each pi I in the worst case, omega n. So I might just be able to sum them up at k, right? That seems to prove the bound at k. Is this okay? Why?
I mean, the cases are different from each other.
Right. So the point is, in the model that I just stated, you know, things can be dynamic, right? So this omega n that I just said, it is true, but it happens for some input, right? So what I can say is that on this particular edge, there has to be omega n bits exchanged for some global input. That's true. There's no denying the fact. But how do I make sure that there is a globally consistent input on which, on each of these edges at the same time, I get omega n bits? Unless I have that, I just cannot add up the worst cases together, right? And this is where randomization helps, because if you can show that in expectation the communication is omega n bits over a global distribution of inputs, then you indeed can add up things, right? And this is the thing that I want to just run over quickly, which is that now suppose here's a different argument, which is a correct argument, which looks at the following distribution. So I define the following global distribution of inputs, which is that I choose a random n-bit string and I give all the players this n-bit string, x. You claim that you have a correct protocol, right? And now you look at the this particular cut. So you have k cuts, right? I am looking at any one of these cuts, and everything here collapses to this one x. And if you think about the argument that I gave you about the two-party lower bound before, that is showing something slightly stronger. What it's showing is that for this particular distribution, since each of these transcripts have to be different to this particular distribution, the expected cost is omega. Okay? Just refer back to the argument that I went through, so this might be a little too fast for some of you, but believe me, and you can just think about it, you will see that that argument showed that the two-party expected cost is omega n. And now we are in good shape, because now I can use the Boolean linearity of expectation and just sum up the inputs, the length of the transcripts, and I'll get omega n. Okay? Now I have a consistent global distribution, and what I proved is actually something stronger, that the expected cost, not just the worst case cost, the expected cost happens to be NP. Okay? So that was for equality, and what one can show is that, you know, the same argument sort of goes through for arbitrary graphs. Okay? And what one can show is, I don't have the time to, I might come back to that later, but what one can show is this very interesting thing, that the cost for computing equality on an arbitrary graph with k nodes is exactly the cost of the Steiner tree cost of hooking up those k nodes times n. Okay, and the same argument will just give you that. Okay, and it's sort of hard to see that there is there's an obvious protocol by merging things together which matches that bar. Okay, so for a general graph, the equality cost, the complexity of equality is the Steiner tree, the cost of the optimal Steiner tree for hooking up those k nodes times n. Okay? And now let's get back to element distinctness. So what's a naive algorithm? A naive algorithm does the following, right? And for a general graph, what the naive algorithm does is it tries to find, so this green node is a particular node that the players settle upon beforehand when they design their protocol. Well, this particular node has a property that the sum of the distances to all the terminals from this node is minimized. Okay, and in the graph theory literature, this is such a node in the graph, is called the median node. Okay, and now what the protocol does is, the naive protocol does, is that all players, they send hashes of their inputs to this median node, and the median node does the computation for you. It checks whether all the hashes are distinct. Okay, and what we show is that, so this particular cost is called sigma g, is the cost of the optimal randomized protocol. Essentially, there's nothing better than you. Okay. And this is the main argument that I want to show. So for instance, on a path, this would give me omega k squared. Okay. I still don't get the log k factor, which seems to be creeping in the upper bound. Okay. And that's an interesting open question, whether you can recover the log k factor. Any questions? So on a different graph, for example, a root k grid, this cost will be different, this will be k to the 3 halves. Now let's go through the argument. This argument actually turns out to be quite simple. Okay. To prove for the general graph, the argument is still simple, but you have to use the right set of proofs. Okay, using the right set of proofs, the argument is simple, and I plan to give you the whole argument. Here's the thing. So here's the first method that you want to try. Just as before, you look at cuts separating. The set of cuts that you look at is sort of suggested by the graph, right? I mean, every edge suggests a cut. Okay, so you look at the cut corresponding to S, that edge is the only cut edge. Okay? And you have answer for our two sides. You look at, now what is the two-party problem induced by this cut? Well, Alice has x1 through xi on one side of the cut, and Bob has xi plus 1 to xk on the other side. And for element distinctness, what you want to ensure is that these things are different, right? So let's assume that x1 to xi are themselves distinct, otherwise it's a trivial problem. And xi plus 1 to xk is also distinct, otherwise again it's a trivial problem. Now, here, assuming that these are distinct x1 to xi, the reserve and xi plus 1 to xk, what is the problem that Alice and Bob are solving, you know, or the protocol that you have for element distinctness is forcing Alice and Bob to solve across this cut is essentially whether the set A is disjoint from the set B. Right? So this is our old friend, set disjointness in the k equals 2 case. Right? And you want to see if this is disjoint, if these two sets are disjoint. So the cost of this, by what we saw before in the randomized case, is going to be the minimum of I. So Alice has I elements and Bob has k minus I elements, and the old lower bound of Rasborov would show that this is at least, the cost is at least minimum of the 2 I and k minus I, and you now want to sum up this and you get exactly k squared, right? Well, again, there is this thing that I just said, this is not quite true because of the little annoying problem that we referred to, because again, it's the worst case cost. Okay? And again, I want to say that this is where randomized, proving a lower bound for randomized protocols actually helps, because you're proving a stronger thing, and often times proving a stronger thing becomes easier. So you look at the you design a hard distribution mu. What is this global distribution mu that you design? Which is that, you know, x1 through xk are some random distinct numbers. This is going to be your distribution. Okay? Keep in mind that you have a right protocol, although, you know, if these are random distinct numbers, just as before in the case of equality, you could say that the answer is always 1. But we are always looking at the behavior of a correct protocol, right? The distribution is this, but the behavior, but you are assuming that the protocol is correct. Okay. And you look at this cut CI as before, you now know that you have to solve this set disjointness problem across this cut. Okay, and you want to solve whether A is disjoint from B. And what happens is that if you look at Rasborov's proof, you can show that Rasborov's proof for this particular distribution will give you exactly the cost that you are looking at. Okay? This is not hard. This is just an observation looking at the original proof. Okay? So this is the minimum of I, k minus I, and now the proof works very nicely. You can indeed sum it up, this is linear to your expectation, and you get k squared. Okay? Now this is on a path. Now let's look at a slightly more involved graph, which is the grid. Okay? And again, the distribution is always going to be the same. I don't need to change the distribution. An interesting aspect of this argument is that the distribution is independent of the topology. Okay? So again, you will choose the distribution of k random distinct numbers, and now you look at the natural set of cuts, which is a set of cuts which are vertical, and then another set of cuts which are horizontal. Right? And you play the same game again. Now, okay, so some things haven't shown up correctly. So this would be, so this is a root k by root k grid. So this should be I times square root of k, because this is square root of k, right? And this should be square root of k minus I times again square root of k. And you're trying to see if A disjoint from B, and you do the same argument. Sorry for this mess up of symbols, but you will get what you want, right? So you can. So you do the same argument with a set of horizontal cuts, and you notice the following. You know, each edge across this cut, this is a very important thing. What happens in the previous argument and in this argument is that each edge appears as a cut edge in exactly one cut. Right? That's important. That's what allows you to sum them up and not overcut. Right? But of course, in a general graph, how do you find a set of cuts? Right? And what kind of cuts do you need to find? So this also works for higher dimensional grids, because you will have this family of cuts, one set of family for each dimension, and it will still work out. Now, it turns out what is remarkable, and this is not to us, this is sitting on the shoulders of giants, is that it's enough to solve this problem for grids. Okay? This is where we're going to use results from before. As I said, if you know what tools you have to use, this is not hard, but these are very nice results. So, which involves metric embeddings. So, what you do is this, these sort of people, Bourguin and London, Linear and Rabinovich, what they showed is if I give you an arbitrary graph, you can always place this nodes of this graph on a grid, okay, on a high dimensional grid. Although I've shown you a two dimensional grid, a high, very high log k dimensional, about log k dimensional grid with a set of very interesting properties. Okay, and what are those properties? Now look at this u prime and v prime. Now for every edge uv on the original graph, so this u got mapped to u prime and v got mapped to v prime, for every edge, the L1 distance of, so which is basically the grid distance, right? The grid distance between u prime and v prime is not too large. It's about log k. So it got stretched a bit, but not by too much. Okay? And if you look at any pair of points, arbitrary points, which are not necessarily connected by an edge, so here I've looked at w prime and x prime, which are the images of, sorry, which is where w and x got mapped to, this is also never shrinks. So edges do not get stretched too much, nor do distances shrink, right? This is where it basically shows there's no distortion in this embedding, which says that if you, so essentially the distance between w prime and x prime, the grid distance, the L1 distance, is at least the distance, the graph distance. So there are two metrics, the graph metric and the grid metric. Okay? And you can sort of, in the language of metric embeddings, you can embed a graph metric onto a grid metric, the L1 metric, with low distortion. Okay? And this is a very important and classical result by now, first shown by Jean Bourguin. And now this is, turns out that this is all we needed, okay? Because we know how to do, how to solve the problem on grids, okay? So we will look at the set of cuts that the grid wants us to look at. The set of horizontal cuts along the grid, the set of vertical, actually it's a high dimensional grid, so we'll look at a family of cuts for each dimension. And these cuts induce cuts in the original graph, right? This is the mapping you have. Right? The grid suggests a cut on the grid, but then that induces a cut on the original graph, right?
Yes. So, how are these Elven norms going to affect with respect to the separators?
The cuts. Yeah. So one has to be a little careful with these two properties. I'm going to come to that. So these two properties will turn out to be exactly what you mean. Okay. So this is just as I was saying, we will look at these sort of cuts and let's look at that, right? So here's Alice and Bob on the grid. So we are looking at, remember we are looking at the cuts that the grid suggests, but you have to, as you said, you have to keep track of what's happening in the original graph. So again, in terms of the grid, you know, as before, you will get this cost which I showed. And here's a little massaging that you can do, which says, yeah, bear with me with a little bit of math here because I think the proof is so pretty that I just got tempted into showing you this. So this minimum of I k minus I, right, you can just write it in this way, that's not hard, okay? And this is obviously exactly equal, is at least lower bounded by I times k minus I by k because maximum of this is k, at most k, right? And what is this I times k minus I? This is exactly the number of pairs that the cut separates, right? Okay, so we got that, right? We're still on the grid, okay? And if you sum them up, you get this. So 1 by k comes out, and you sum up over all cuts. The cuts have been suggested by this grid. And now when you sum them up over all, so you rewrite the sum as, you know, you look at all pairs w x, that is the thing on the top, you can exactly rewrite the number of cuts that separate this w prime x prime, right? Okay? Okay, so now what you get is, well, because these cuts are designed such nicely, this is exactly the element is, it's also called the cut metric for that reason, right? So it's exactly this. And so for every pair Wx, we know also this is using the first property of the cut, right? The first property that we have about the embedding is that this distance is at least the distance in the original graph metric. And so you can do this thing, okay? You can lower bound this way. And now if you think about this, so again, you rewrite this using all w, and then look at all x not equal to w and look at dwx. Yeah, this is just rewriting. What is this quantity, right? This quantity is exactly, if I were to choose x as my center point, right, median point, it's not the median, right? So this quantity would be just, you're looking at the sum of the distances from that point to all the terminals, right? And this is at least sigma g, okay? Because sigma g is the minimum of all that, and you're dividing it by 1 over k. So you get exactly sigma g by 2, right? So you recover sigma g exactly, it's like a little half factor. And so when you sum it up, I mean, I'm sort of ignoring the by 2 now, okay? So you get sigma g. So your total cost, now you start summing up over all n, so your total cost is going to be, because this is an expected cost by linearity of expectation, you can rewrite it in this way. And here's the crucial second property that we're going to use, okay? The second property is that for every edge, uv, well, this got stretched out by at most log k. So, and in other words, this pair u prime v prime would be separated in at most log k cuts. So a particular edge which connected uv will therefore appear in at most log k of cuts, right? Because the number of times I'll cut this is exactly the cut metric, is exactly this distance. Okay? And you get this 1 over log k factor because you count this possible log k overcount. Okay? And so this is what I meant by, if I ignore this 1 over log k, I get exactly the same value. Okay? So this star appeared a little before here, so actually we should have appeared after this step, which is where I'm sort of ignoring the log k factor. Okay? Log k, I'm sort of getting this log k because of the distortion involved in the embedding. Okay, so right. So you recover exactly the sigma g except this log k factor loss. And here's another very interesting open question. Well, this is what you did. This log k could be an artifact of the proof because we went from metric embeddings. For metric embeddings, you have to have this log k factor loss. This is well known. But for the communication problem, why do you have to go through metric embeddings? There could be other ways of doing this, and this, it might seem a technical question, but I think it's a very interesting mathematical question to find out whether this log k loss is necessary, or for some graphs there are sort of interesting protocols that actually, I'll be very surprised if that happens, that actually you can save this log k. A particular graph to look at is this expander graphs, where expander graphs you can show that this metric embeddings need to lose this log k. So expander graphs are the right graphs to look at to see if this log k loss is sort of unavoidable. Okay, so have I run out of time? Or another 5 minutes? So we were able to show, so these are functions, so element distinctness is a function which we call a one median type function because the cost here depends on the median of the graph, right? And as we saw before, that not all functions will have this one median cost. Element distinctness has this one, it's a one median type function because the one median of the graph becomes the key parameter, but we just saw that equality. For equality, it is Steiner tree, right? And So equality we call is a Steiner tree feedback function. There are clearly two different types of function, Steiner tree type, where Steiner tree, and there is some connection to streaming here, because you know, Steiner tree type things are things which well, naturally you can sort of merge streams. If you can merge streams, it seems you get Steiner tree type functions, and if you can't at all merge, then you get one linear type functions. There might be all sorts of things living in the middle, where you can submerge somewhat, perhaps, the amount of space needed, then you might get a different topological parameter, which is the right parameter. So anyway, so if you look at, I wanted to show you this example of bitwise XOR, so where this is not, sorry, this is, as I said, we will look at only Boolean functions, but this is not an example of a Boolean function. So bitwise XOR is a case where, you know, you just do the bitwise XOR, so you output n bits. Okay, and again, this is a Steiner tree type function, but of a different type, in the sense that the Steiner tree shows up as a graph parameter, but you also have this n as multiplicative factor. So this we call the linear Steiner tree type, whereas this one is just Steiner tree type. Okay, so we have all sorts of classification of functions. And here's actually a very natural connection to LP, which is what we think is the right way to look at this sort of things, and it's not a It's not at all surprising, because this is what has been looked at in the algorithms community when dealing with this. So here's a formulation, a linear programming formulation of the problem. So again, these red nodes are the nodes that are terminals, and you look at a particular cut, and this cut gives rise to an induced function. So you want to solve this function f, and across the cut you get an induced function to be solved by Allison Bohm, right? And these are the cut edges. So there is some depending on the function f. There's another function b which is going to tell you by the corresponding two-party problem that the sum total of the communication along these cut edges need to be some function b of c. Right? So I'm not trying to abstract and give you a general formulation. Okay? And you want to sort of solve this particular LP, which is for all cuts in the graph, you look at the set of cut edges, and let's say the XE here represents the communication, the expected communication that happens on this edge E. The sum of that must be at least B of C. And this constraint arises by the communication problem, the two-party communication problem that's induced across this cut, and then you want to minimize the sum of XC, right? This minimal is certainly going to be a lower bound on the total cost, right? But every protocol has to have this cost, right? So this LP is of course going to be a lower bound. The solution to this LP, it's not clear whether this LP is also going to be an upper bound. But certainly is a lower one. Okay? And yeah, so these are just, as I said, with respect to, so you have to choose the right mu that maximizes this, right? So, and this is exactly the way to recover the Steiner tree bound, which is the following. So let's look at, for simplicity, let's look at the non-Boolean function, which is the bitwise XOR, and I'm looking at this particular cut, an arbitrary cut, where, you know, I now look at the uniform distribution, okay? So the global distribution, so this is just an instantiation of the abstract framework that I just said. The uniform distribution is my global mu. And you can sort of reason it out that by a simple information theoretic argument, the expected cost of solving this problem, the XOR problem across a cut, is going to be omega n. Right, just by information theory. And if you look at the LP, so this I've normalized on the right side, so yeah, going a little fast here, you can ask me. So anyway, it turns out that this is the normalized LP, the same LP. And it's well known here in this case that, you know, the Steiner tree cost is sort of sandwiched between you know, this the LP and twice that LP. Okay? And so whereas we know that the Steiner tree cost is also an upper bound, okay? And this, in this particular case, it so happens Therefore, the LP gives you sort of within, gets you within a factor half of the optimal cost. Okay, and we recover this, which is that solving the XOR problem requires n times the standard tree cost. Okay, but as I said, there are many interesting functions for which we do not know this, that the standard tree, that the LP is the optimal cost. Okay, and I think this area is wide open. I mean, you know, for those problems, how do you prove an optimal lower bound? One last thing, let's come back to this key function set disjointness, because you might also think it would be remarkable if somehow solving the two-party problems and sort of just looking at this two-way cuts is always going to give us the right bound. Why should that happen? Right? I mean, the problem seems to be, for other problems, it should not. It would make it strange if always two-party lower bounds can be sort of massaged to give you lower bounds in general. And set disjointness indeed turns out to be one problem for which these two-party problems do not seem to give you a lower bound. Two-party communication constraints do not seem to work. If you think about it for a while, you will see that every distribution that you try to solve using when you look at the cut, the distribution just destroys the whole problem. It becomes a trivial two-party problem. Okay? So I don't want to take too much time. I just want to say that we were also able to show that for set disjointness, we can still recover the almost the optimal cost, except we lose again the log squared a factor. And this requires some other kind of technique, which requires sort of going through k-way cuts rather than one-way cut. And I don't have time for that, but this also has interesting algorithmic techniques. So let me just, there are other things here. Let me skip all that and then we come to open problems. Okay. So, as I said, we have just, I think this is a very nice thing to look at. There is going to be interesting algorithmic techniques with information theoretic techniques to be brought together to solve this thing. And these seem to be very natural generalizations of two-party communication problem. So one thing that people have looked at, and I didn't get time to talk about, is composing functions. So set disjointness, equality, these are all composed functions. Okay? And in communication complexity, you start with, very recently there have been several results of this type, where you sort of take two simple functions, compose them, and then the composition itself suggests a protocol, which is basically solve these two simple functions independently, and then you know take nice protocol that sort of combines this. Okay? This is also known as lifting and other, it's known variously in various parts of complexity theory. So what happens when you, here one interesting case is suppose F and G have very different topological behaviors. So now we're talking about general graphs. When you compose two such functions, what happens to the complexity of the composed function? Does the naive protocol, is it always the optimal one? The other question is, get rid of the log factor losses. So is metric embeddings the only way to prove lower bounds here? Is it tight? This I think is a very interesting question. And the other thing that I said might not have emphasized is this fact that for element distinctness, as far as I know, we still haven't got the optimal deterministic lower bound. Okay? We could prove the randomized lower bound, but it seems now we don't know how to prove for a general graph. Maybe on the line graph, on the path we can prove for a general graph, we don't seem to have a way of proving better proving optimal, even near optimal deterministic lower bound. Okay? So this is something that is sort of perplexing, that deterministic lower bounds are hard to prove here, because all we can do is sort of sum up this expected cost. Is there a better way of doing things which can give us tighter deterministic lower bounds? And the last point is sort of very general, which is can we develop a general theory of communication complexity in the point-to-point model? There are all sorts of questions, take the important questions from two party and try to generalize it to the k party. Thank you.
Do we have any questions?
So this is perhaps orthogonal to what you presented, but is there some sense of the inverse problem? So given some communication budget, what kind of networks, minimally connected networks, might realize that budget? Or is there some understanding on those lines?
Sorry, this one?
Is there some understanding on those lines? Like what kind of networks give you a...
You mean try to design algorithms
design
so that given a budget, come up with a... Yeah, so this kind of problems have been looked at in the algorithms community, where you have a particular budget and you want to design your, you want to do network design, right? In the communication complexity setting, we have not, but that's an interesting direction, but as you said, it's a little, the direction is orthogonal. We are a function, and we, yeah, so I haven't looked at that.
Okay, thank you very much for the talk.